If you want to share your screen and get started.
Yes. So
Cool.
hopefully everybody can see my screen.
Yes, looks good.
Perfect. Okay, yeah then. Thank you very much, first of all, for the invitation to join the Vendor Summit and to present our company here. So today I'm going to tell you a little bit about the company Backoff and how we got started with FreeBSD. So my name is Heiko Wilke. I'm product manager at Backoff for the embedded PCs, which I will show you in a couple of slides. Okay, first of all, I plan to show you a video which shows Backoff in 45 seconds. Unfortunately, that didn't work when we tested it last week. So Zoom crashed. So I don't want to happen that again. So I just put you the link here and you can have a look at YouTube for that. So I explain it to you in a short slides. So Backoff, in fact, is doing industrial automation. And industrial automation means we are building industrial controllers, industrial motors, so that you can automate a machine. If you're thinking about machine, there are of course a lot of discrete manufacturing machines which you can see here in different areas. But it is not only related to discrete manufacturing. It can also be in other areas, for example, process industry. It can be building automation. Wind turbine is, for example, also very big part of our business. We are roughly equipping more than 50% of the wind turbines in China with Backoff controllers. We are in the semiconductor industry, so there are really multiple industries. So we have no dedicated target industry for our devices and applications. So Backoff itself is a family-owned company founded 1980 in the middle of Germany. We could say in the middle of nowhere. So Föhrl is a small town in Germany with 26,000 people living there. The company developed quite well. So in the meantime, we are roughly 4,400 people worldwide, one-third roughly engineers. So we are I would say a technical-driven company, so strong technical background. We claim that we are a billion-dollar company since last year. So these are the values you see are the euro values. So euro is usually a little bit less. So in dollars, it's a roughly billion-dollar company. Now, this year is of course a little bit difficult, but it seems that we can still keep at least the numbers from last year. To give you an idea where we are located, more or less all over the world, we have own Backoff offices. We are usually having a direct sales approach so that we have really our application engineers on site. They can directly help customers. We have also now in Colorado an office next to the FreeBSD Foundation, or next, I think it's a couple of kilometers away, but it's quite close. This is the idea, because our idea, or the idea of our owner, is that we need to understand the problem, the technical problems from the customers, so that we can find solutions for them with our technology. Okay, what does it mean? What are we selling? So we are selling a toolbox for automation. And this toolbox consists out of multiple parts. One part is the IPC part. This is also the part where I'm coming from. So I'm responsible for these smaller controllers, which you see on the bottom line. Maybe you can, here you see that. We are producing these PCs in Germany. We have our own motherboard development in Germany. We also have our own BIOS development group, which is of course based on AMI BIOSes, but in fact, we can adapt the BIOS for our needs. We also have our own assembly in Germany. So we have completely producing the PCs in Germany next to our headquarters. Yeah. So everything is coming directly from us. And this makes it possible for us to really be able to, we have everything under control of the device, including really the motherboard itself and the BIOS. Then we have the IOs. The IOs are, of course, necessary. If the PC is the heart of the machine or the brain of the machine, the IOs are usually the arms and legs, the actors, or the sensors and actors. So they are collecting the inputs or, of course, are setting the outputs, for example, contactors or whatever. These are available also in all different flavors. So these are very small IP20 terminals. We have this in IP67. And all that electronic is also, of course, developed by us and also produced in Germany. We are supporting many different field buses. You see here all these different logos. So all these field buses are supported because we want to have an open system so which can connect to more or less anything. And then on the hardware side, the third part is, of course, motion parts. You also need motion in your machine. So we also offer servo drives. You see here, these are servo drives for servo motors, which we also produce. So we also have an own motor factory, which is not directly at the headquarters. It's roughly 200 kilometers south of our headquarters in the southern part of Germany. But this is our motor factory there. And on the right side, you see some very nice things, which are very special motion applications, which you would see in the video. This is a linear transport system, which is quite unique. And then we have something which is called Explanar. It's we call it internally the flying carpet because you have flying movers, which are hovering over tiles. Yeah. Very unique. And also only possible because we have the full control over all these parts here. And with our Fieldbus EtherCAT, which I will also show you later, we have also the speed to deliver these IO information as fast as possible. And on top of everything, we have our software, which I'm talking today a little bit about. And this is which at the end handles everything on the PC. So which is doing the real time, which is doing the PLC, which is doing the motion control and so on. So these icons just represent multiple parts and functionalities of our software tool suite. Okay, back of milestones. I will not explain you all these different milestones. So this is our standard slide. Just go to the next one. And I just picked some of these milestones. So we started in 1980, as I mentioned. Our boss started this company. Like every company, it started in a garage, or like every good startup, it started in a garage. We started with microcontroller-based machine controllers. And in 1986, our boss invented the PC-based control system. At this time, all the PLCs were just microcontroller-based. And in this year, a customer of us asked him to connect a floppy drive to his machine controller, to the microcontroller. And then they started to develop it, and they connected it to the PC, a standard PC at this time. I don't know what it was, 286 or 386, something like that, to the microcontroller-based machine controller. And someone, they said, hey, that's stupid what we are doing, because we are just talking with a very powerful PC, which we just use as a floppy drive via a serial interface to this very small 16-bit controller. Doesn't make any sense. We can do the same thing on top of the PC beside everything else. And this was the birth of PC-based control as we know it today. So Beckhoff really started that. And already 2 years later, they had a standard system called S1000 based on DOS at this time, which already handled the PLC and motion control. And then the next major step was 1996, with the invention of TwinCAD, which was then the first time when this software, so this soft PLC, you could say, worked and run on Windows. And this is also where this Twin came from. So in the first time we showed it was called WinCAD, but there was an issue with the name with another company. So we had to rename it, and then it was called TwinCAD. So the Windows Computer Automation Technology. Okay, so this was the birth of TwinCAD as we know it today. And then 5 years later, we started smaller embedded PCs, which were based on Windows CE. And so this was the introduction of the second operating system at Beckhoff. So the big Windows NT line, and then Windows CE as well. I just take 2004 here as the birth of EtherCAT. I just mentioned that here because this is usually very well known, EtherCAT, in the world, and sometimes it's more known than Beckhoff. So a lot of people which we are talking to, they know EtherCAT, but they don't know Beckhoff, and they think, okay, EtherCAT, we know that, of course, but you invented it. Yeah, it's, we have to explain that sometimes, and then we say, yeah, we invented that in this time. Yeah, so it's a very successful over the year as a standard Ethernet-based field bus, which yeah still is the fastest Ethernet-based field bus. Yeah, then in 2010, our new TwinCAT software came out, TwinCAT 3, which was then based on multi-core, which can use multi-cores and is also 64-bit based. And now in 2020, this is what we are talking about today, is our next operating system in our range, which is of course some kind of a replacement for existing Windows CE, which we call TwinCAT BSD. Okay, just to give you an idea what we think or how we think about PC, industrial PC with a machine controller. So we take a standard PC, of course, it's not everything standard, but let's say it's more or less standard architecture, x86 architecture, Intel CPU. And then we put our software on it. And then we have one part of the software is doing the PLC, which can have multiple tasks in real time. One part is doing the motion control, which doing point to point, CNC, whatever. We have then also some other functions here. Now we also have some functions for vision as well and for machine learning. So there are all these things running in the real time. And then we have this IO mapping here. And this mapping maps these inputs and outputs to the right field bus. In our case, we prefer, of course, EtherCAT. EtherCAT is then going to all these I/O slaves and or servo drives. And the idea here is that these slaves or these IOs are, let's say, stupid. Stupid means there is no pre-processing within these devices. So they just set outputs or just gather inputs. That's their purpose and nothing else. So the approach is here always to do everything which needs to be calculated and which needs to be processed has to be processed in the PC, because the PC always gives us enough capabilities, always enough performance to do everything we need in the software as a software component here. Yeah, so this is the approach since 1986 and which worked quite well. Okay, what does real-time mean for us? So we have something which we call XFC, Extreme Fast Control Technology. In fact, it's a marketing word around the standard capabilities of EtherCAT. So EtherCAT has a very fast, can very fast collect inputs and send outputs. And together with TwinCAT and with our real-time, we can realize IO response time below 100 microseconds. That means you have an input here, an electrical input, 24 volt or whatever. This input comes, then you, of course, you have some internal electrical conversion until it's get into the slave controller. Then it gets processed or gets transferred via EtherCAT to the PC. On the PC, the PLC task is running, doing its calculation. When it's ended, it's sending the outputs as over EtherCAT again. Then this telegram is received in the output terminal, and then it's processed. And somewhere then there is a 24 volt output signal, and this everything is done below 100 microseconds. And this helps customers to really improve their control loops. Reduce waste, for example, optimize the output of the machine. Okay, so what is TwinCAT? TwinCAT, in fact, is our software tool suite, which makes the PC real-time capable. There are lots of different TwinCAT functionalities, I would say. So all these modules you see here are parts of TwinCAT. which you can use, but you can also just use one of these parts. The base system is always the system which provides the real time. And on the real time, you can run PLC tasks, you can run your own C++ modules, you can run the safety functions, you can run vision applications, you can do motion and so on. HMI, of course, is not based or it's not directly in the real time. HMI is then a product which is running in user mode and on top of that. If we are talking about real time in our world, this means usually that we are talking about milliseconds at least, or even microseconds. And our system has a cyclical approach. That means we are defining a certain cycle time, for example, 1 millisecond. And that means each millisecond, the PLC or whatever task gets called and has to execute and has to do its operation. And when it's finished, you can say sleeps again and waits for the next cycle tick. That is the approach. And it's not in a free run state that it always, if it's ended, it starts again. So it's really always the same cycle time and it doesn't just start earlier or anything. We can reach cycle times down to 12.5 microseconds. That's possible. And we already showed that, but that's getting really complicated in kind of parameterization and everything. So usually in the real world application, you will see cycle times with down to 50 microseconds. This is something which you can more or less easily handle. Okay, then TwinCAD consists more or less out of two parts. So one part is the engineering part, which is in Visual Studio integrated. And there you configure your system. You can program all your logic in C++, C, or IEC 61131, so PLC language. You can also use MATLAB Simulink. And this is, of course, done on Windows and will also stay on Windows. So this is a Windows application, but if we are talking about the second part, which is the runtime part, this is what we have now ported to FreeBSD. And so we can now use our real time on a FreeBSD system. It's not exactly FreeBSD, it's some slightly modifications there, but more or less it's FreeBSD, and we call that then TwinCAD BSD. And this is the part which then executes all these different modules which you can use there. So all the runtime products will be available then for that TwinCAD BSD. Okay, here you see the architecture. These are the two parts, engineering part and the runtime part. The runtime part, as I mentioned, is now ported to this FreeBSD. We have our own transport layer, which is called ADS. And this is usually transferred over Ethernet. So that means usually you have the programming on your laptop on Windows with this Visual Studio environment, TwinCAD XAE. And then you have your target system, for example, this embedded PC with your IOs, and you connect them with wire network. And then you can directly scan the system here, get all the IO information, and then you can parameterize it. You can do all the settings, and then you can somewhere download your application here, and then you run it here on the runtime system, on the target. As I mentioned before, TwinCAD supports multi-cores, and there are different ways how we can make use of multi-cores and how we can use our real-time at all. So we have two different kinds of operating modes for real-time. The first operating mode is the known operating mode, which was already invented with Windows NT 1996. And this means that the shared core, how we call that, the shared core runs or can run up to 80% or can take up to 80% of the CPU time. That means, for example, 1 millisecond cycle time, each millisecond our real time gets called. We are doing our stuff. And for example, after 500 microseconds, we are finished. We are giving back the rest to the OS. You can do that up to 80%. So that means 800 microseconds. If your task or if your PLC execution takes longer, you need to cancel that. Otherwise, if you take more than 80%, you usually get weird behavior of the OS. So over time now with multi-cores, so this was necessary at the time because we only had one core and we had to share that core. Now we have multi-core system and we can do it differently. So here on a multi-core system, we can now set isolated cores. Isolated cores are available after a reboot. So if you have quad core system, your system boots with four cores, and then you say, I want to have two isolated cores. You can do that in the settings of the TwinCAD system, and then you have to reboot once. And after reboot, the operating system only sees or has two cores. So you just say it to, or you just set the operating system, please only initialize two cores. And the other two cores are left. And then TwinCAD takes over these cores, initializes them, and then starts the runtime there. And there we are 100%, we can work on these cores without interfering here any processes on these cores. So this is really a good benefit or a big benefit now for the new TwinCAD 3 system. And you can still, of course, communicate over ADS, this protocol, over between all these different runtimes and tasks, and also from the user mode here on your standard operating system core. We have an ADS lib you can use, and then you can communicate over this ADS protocol into the different runtimes and, for example, get variable information or something like that. Okay, this is how it looks like in the engineering. Here you can set which core you want to have for the OS, which is maybe isolated, which is the base cycle time for the system here down to 50 microseconds. And then you can also set the CPU limits. So this was some short introduction about TwinCAD. Now let's talk about the new operating system. So why did we choose a new operating system, or why did we need a new operating system? So technically it was not necessary, yeah, to be honest. It was not nothing which was technically driven. We're doing that approach which I just showed since 1996 on Windows, and it worked quite well and successful. And the only thing which was now difficult is that Windows CE expires. And this is, I think it's an open secret, or maybe probably well known everywhere, that there is no real successor for Windows CE from Microsoft side anymore. So Windows IoT or Windows 10 IoT Core was on our side under evaluation for, I think, when was it released? I think 2016 or somewhere. But it was, or it's still very limited because it's still based on Windows 10. So it's very, still very big. It has a high requirements in regards to storage and RAM. And it's, for us, it was still too big for the small embedded controllers. And it's also very limited of in kind of the CPU range. So they only pick certain CPUs which are available and where you can run it. And this, the next thing was that more and more customers are asking for non-Windows controllers, to be honest. Yeah, so we have companies who have now new internal regulations or restrictions, and they say we don't allow Windows controllers on the factory floor anymore. Yeah, so this was then the main reason then to say, okay, we need something else. Why did we now choose FreeBSD? Okay, to be honest, we started, of course, first to investigate with Linux, like always. I mean, it's a very widely supported, especially from the hardware side, supported OS. But we stopped very early because of the GPL. And so we tried to figure out if there are some hooks or something which you can do. And we discussed it with legal department, with lawyers and everything. Finally, the problem is that no lawyer, nobody will give you final approval and say, hey, you can do it this way and you are always safe. Yeah, there is no clear law or no clear case that you can do it in a certain way. Yeah, so it's always a gray zone where you are working. And this is something which we do not want. The risk for the company is then too high. So I knew FreeBSD, to be honest, from my home server. So at this time, this is roughly 5 years ago, I was running FreeNAS on my home server, but I was not brave enough to propose it at this time. But in 2017 on the Asia BSD Con, Intel announced that they will support FreeBSD more. So they made a big spending to the FreeBSD Foundation, and they also started this FreeBSD working group, or this development group. And this was for us the initial step to say, okay, Intel is one of our major suppliers because we are mainly based on Intel CPUs. If they are now also supporting that OS, we can start working with it. So how did we switch to FreeBSD then? To be honest, we did not switch. We just added FreeBSD as another operating system for our real time. Yeah, so we are still keeping Windows, Windows 10, the big Windows. Of course, Windows CE is, somewhere expiring, but Windows 10, of course, remains. And of course, we are still supporting Windows 10 and working Windows 10 in parallel, but we are additionally bringing FreeBSD in the name of Twinket BSD to our product roadmap. Already 5 years ago, we started to make our real-time kernel, so the Twinket runtime, more or less independent by creating a platform abstraction layer. This is a driver which takes all the usual hooks you have into the OS. So you have all these, things like PCI device search or some file IO and all this stuff which you usually use from the OS. This went into the abstraction layer. And in 2017, we then started with the FreeBSD development. And now we have finished that. Of course, no software product is never finished, but we have finished that process, I would say. And our system is now built OS independent against this platform abstraction layer driver. So that means we have no external dependencies anymore. We have only this platform abstraction layer. We can now just use a platform abstraction layer for Windows, which is of course different, and one for FreeBSD, but the core itself is the same. Yeah, so the runtime, the binary is the same. And if we would need to support another OS, which allows us to load such a driver into the kernel without major obligations, like releasing the source code, then we could do that as well. Yeah, so what does this driver do? So in fact, it just loads the Twinket runtime, which is a binary module, into the kernel memory. Then it sets up all the necessary environmental hooks. And in fact, then it calls this binary. And though that means also this binary is, of course, platform dependent, so or architectural dependent. So we need different binaries for different architectures. Okay. So the Twinket BSD base system, is roughly, also our base image is roughly 300 megabyte in size, because we are using package base. We decided to use package base because we wanted to have, or we wanted to strip down the system as much as possible, as well as to be able to update all the system components with package. We are using our own kernel, also because the standard FreeBSD kernel didn't work out of the box. There are just some slight changes, which I don't know exactly, but I think there was something with the timing, with the internal timers. It was really just a minor adjustment, which is necessary for us to run properly with our real time. That also means we cannot just install a Twinket runtime on a standard FreeBSD. We really need to have our own kernel. And we have our own real-time network drivers for our used NICs network cards. Then we set up our own back-off package server, where we are hosting our packages from our package base system, from our Twinket world. So all the Twinket functions all are packages, and we also mirror all FreeBSD packages. Yeah, so all the ports are also provided over our package server, so that customers don't need to use different repositories, especially because we have different dependencies. Yeah, so then it would be difficult if you mix it with a standard FreeBSD repository. As I mentioned, Backoff Package Server provides for our customers the OS updates, Twinket updates, and all other package updates, which are just coming from the ports tree. As a file system, we are using ZFS because we tested it a lot and we think it's a very good file system for our needs. Especially we tested this power loss for a very long time, and after some issues which we found with the bootloader, so there was a smaller issue which is but it's fixed now. It's now working without any issue, so we can use it for just switching off the machines. And this is in fact also a thing which a lot of machine builders doing. They're just switching off the machines, so they do not shut it down properly. They just have a main switch and it's switched off, and everything is switched off, and it has to work again if you switch it on. We also provide some other features of the ZFS file system with another name, because we are making it a more simple way for customers. One is we call it backoff restore points, or at least back restore points. That means we are using or we're doing recursive snapshot from the whole pool, of course. This is no secret or nothing special. And then you can roll back to that point in time. And the nice thing here is that it's usually if you're doing a recursive snapshot, you always have to do it with you can do it with this minus R option. But the if you're rolling back everything, it's quite more difficult, because then you have to do everything for every data set by your own. And we also created a restore boot environment so that if the system doesn't start anymore, you can start into that restore boot environment, and then we have a simple comment which you can use, and it's just rolling back to that restore point, and everything is exactly at this point in time. Another feature which we implemented is we call it write filter. This is known from the Windows world. So the Windows embedded operating systems offer that since, I don't know, Windows XP, I think, Windows XP embedded. A write filter is means it's like an overlay for the file system. So the file system is fully protected, and then there is just a RAM overlay, and all the writes are going into the RAM overlay. On Windows, that's getting tricky over time, because if you have a lot of writes going on there, it might happen that your RAM is overflowing, and then you have a problem. There's a reason why we are using now that, or why we are doing it here a little bit differently. We are not protecting the file system, because then you may also have issues, because some writes are then giving you just the feedback, it's protected and I cannot write, so there might be errors. So in fact, what we are doing is, if you enable the write filter, of course we are creating a snapshot, and then we are creating two clones. And then we are always booting into in one of these clones. And if the clone boots, it rolls back the other clone to the snapshot. And when the system reboots again, it's rebooting from the other clone, so it's always booting from the clean clone, I would say. So it's like a ping pong, and that makes it possible. And then you can just you just say, okay, I want to freeze the system now, and then I can switch it off, do whatever I like, or if I do something wrong, I just switch it off, switch it on, and it's back in at the same state. So it's something which also a lot of customers from us use in the Windows environment, and they also want to have that on BSD. And this is the way we did it now with BSD and ZFS. And probably we will also do other things in the future, but these are the two first things which we have now implemented. Next thing is Behive. Behive, we also start working on to make to create an environment for the customers to use their Docker containers. So, because we have really a lot of requests for Docker support from our customer base. Of course, we try to explain them that there are other technologies like Jails, but yeah, sometimes there is maybe less knowledge and they just know the Docker name and say, we need Docker. Sometimes they just have already implemented Docker in their internal environments and everything, and they just need that or want that to deploy their systems. Therefore, we are currently preparing a script or, let's say, some kind of a button in our device management website so that the customer can easily then set up a system or a Docker environment by we're creating a virtual machine with a small Linux image with a Docker engine inside, and then he can then install his Docker containers in that system. But this is not yet finished, and to be honest, we are open for discussion. So if you have other ideas, if you have similar issues, and maybe we also find a good solution for the whole FreeBSD system, that would be great from my point of view. Okay, last but not least, customer feedback so far. So we are in contact with customers since 2 years now. For me directly in contact with them, and until now, all of them appreciate a non-Windows OS, of course. And most of them also, give us a very positive feedback about FreeBSD as a base. So we have a lot of people saying, hey, FreeBSD, I used it in the past, but in my company, we just use Linux. Nevertheless, they really appreciate that. We have these issues with Linux that customers require or ask for Linux so that they can run their Docker containers. But if we solve that in a different way, maybe with a virtual machine, let's see how we really solve that at the end, then this is also a no issue anymore. Yeah, so, and then we have really a good system where we really can satisfy our customers. Beside that, we're also doing a lot of education for customers about FreeBSD, because of course we always explain where we are based on, because as you have seen, we have a very open system, so it's not closed, so not like a PlayStation or something like that, which is completely closed and you don't need to know what's going on there. Our customers want to know that, because we always sell an open system, because we want to make it open that customers can really implement new applications. Because if you close everything down, then of course the customer can also not do anything there. So this was also in the past with on Windows, customers used the system also to add additional software on the system as well. And this is the benefit and the nice thing about the PC-based automation. And a lot of education also about FreeBSD as a Linux distribution. So you probably all know that, but really we have a lot of people thinking, okay, FreeBSD, that's one of the Linux distributions. And then you need to explain them, hey, that's not a Linux distribution. It's a full blown OS and Linux is just a kernel. And it's sometimes quite interesting to see their reaction. This was my last slide. So I hope I got you a small introduction to Backoff and how we use FreeBSD. Now I think we have maybe 5 minutes, I think, for questions. I just answer them here. So wanna ask, I wonder what stack they use for CANBOS. So the fieldbus stacks we are using are part of TwinCAT. So CANBOS, Profibus, Profinet, which are developed by our own. So the stacks are not external stacks, so they are our own stacks. The next question, Sean. What security process or technology do you apply on the FreeBSD-based system? To be honest, I need to answer that later on. Of course, we are using PF firewall, so to really limit everything on the network side. Internally, we are just starting with address space, local randomization. I need to figure out what else we are doing there. So I need to talk to the developers. Next question from Tommy. Do you follow current stable or release with FreeBSD source? So we are following release. Sorry. Yeah, I think it's release. So because we're just switching now to 12.2. So we always use the latest released version of FreeBSD. That's what we are doing. Yeah. Maybe we will change somewhere, but this is at the moment the plan, and yeah, which works quite well. Okay. Then I would say, oh yeah, you just took over. So yeah, then thank you very much. And yeah, I hope we can work more together then in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Heiko. Oh, we have one more question. So I'll pop back over to you. Justin Gibbs had a question if you're ready.
Yes. okay, Justin, what is the rough split of deployments between Windows and FreeBSD? Is that trend changing? to be honest, we're just starting to ship next month, so I cannot tell you the split because there is no, or not the the trend, because there is no trend at today. Next year, I may give you a better answer about that.